I started my career in or in my studies I did in Wageningen, and then I worked for a few years in industry. Then I went back to university, did my PhD and postdoc in the aerobic granular sludge technology. So that will also be one of the lectures, how we go from lab scale to full scale, because I worked at the whole development of the aerobic granular sludge technology, the NIREDA system. After that, I worked at one of the Dutch water boards for a few years, so at the end user side, and then I decided to come back to university last year. So, well, I'm happy that you are in this course. The other, the course responsible person is Jules van Leer. He's the professor of wastewater treatment, and he will teach the anaerobic part of this lecture series. So the outline of the course that you are going to follow is as follows. These are the learning goals. So after this course, the main thing I would like you to know is how to select for which new technologies at which moment. So in the exam, we might give you a raw sketch about the situation, like this is a Dutch wastewater treatment plant, it needs to be expanded, space is limited, and water boards focus a lot on energy, and then after this course series you have to know which technology you should pick then. So in then identify and compare innovations, you should always also have to be able to do some basic design calculation, especially on the anaerobic wastewater treatment part, because that was the part that was not dealt with in the bachelor course. So the basic design of activated sludge systems are already addressed in the bachelor course, but the conventional anaerobic systems, which are not that conventional, is addressed here. Well, the topics we're going to discuss is that we will look at new developments and new technologies, basically, and advanced treatments. So the basic treatments, activated sludge, we expect that it's more or less in your mind. What to do if you have to go to really low NPBOD concentrations? What should you add to a system? What do you do if you want to treat your water anaerobically, if you want to get biogas, all that kind of things? Well, as I mentioned, I give you an introduction to aerobic granular sludge technology. We will discuss the interactions between sewage collection and treatment, because that is a connection that's often forgotten. When we start with wastewater treatment, we always start at the beginning of the treatment plant, and we just see what comes in and how we are going to treat it. But sometimes you can adjust already something up front in the sewage system. Anaerobic technologies we will address, so the fundamentals, dimensioning and performance calculations of anaerobic treatment. Look at resource-oriented sanitation, so separated streams at the source, so in the toilet or in the households, and what you can do then with those streams. Use of treated effluents in agriculture, because many places on Earth face drought, and wastewater could be a good stream to use in agriculture. And one fun thing we will do in January is look at the resource factory, and that is a new development in the Netherlands, where the wastewater that comes in at the treatment plant is not looked at as a waste that we have to get rid of as soon as possible, but more as a source. What is in it that we can use for other applications? So this last day, people from the Dutch water boards will come and teach you about this way of thinking for wastewater treatment. And we will also play a game to look at different stakeholders who will be important, and we do a case study. So that is kind of a roundup of everything that you learned in the course. And then there will be a BioWin modeling part in this course as well. The lectures is on Blackboard. If you could not find it yet, it's below course information. You have a tab course schedule, and then you come to the schedule of the lecture series. So have a look there when we are going to address what. And then we have a BioWin simulation that's given by my colleague Henry Spanjers. He is associate professor in our group. And that one will start next week on Thursday afternoon. you will have a few afternoons with in the introduction and then a few exercises, and then just before Christmas you can do the assignment and then round everything up in that period. Then we also have practicals, kind of a nuisance that that's not in your schedule. So we have to get some extra afternoons or mornings from you, and I will come back to in the end of the morning. I will discuss that more. But there are three really nice experiments, I think. Course material will be put on Blackboard. It's mainly the lecture notes you're taking right now. The slides, the presentations will be on Blackboard. There will be also some reading material. Last year I put a lot of things on Blackboard for the people who followed last year. Now I will be a bit more specific about what is really studying material and what is more background reading material that it's nice to know of, but that does not need to be studied in detail. As you can see, these classes will be taped on Collegerama. So also if you think, well, what did she say again, you can just look it up at Collegerama again. Metcalf and Eddy, the big book, is it's reference material. We're not using that book here in class, but it's a really nice book as a wastewater treatment engineer later on to have. Everything is in it, so yeah, if you like, you can buy it or borrow it from the library just to look at the background of everything we do. There will be practicum manuals and the BioWin handout. So that's all the study material. Your final mark will be 50% the mark of your exam, 25% of the practicals, and 25% will be the BioWin assignment. Yes?
Is there a reader?
There's not really a reader. There will be information on Blackboard, but the lectures and everything presented in the slides will be your main study material. What I would like to do in this lecture, I first would like to know you a bit better, so where you come from and what your background is, because then I also, and especially also if you followed the bachelor here in Delft and if you followed the fundamentals course of the master. So start, who is a bachelor student of TU Delft? Two, okay. Who did follow the bachelor sanitary engineering 3420 on Collegerama, or only the two, three? Okay, good, thank you. That is basic knowledge that I expect you to have to follow this course. So there everything is dealt with: conventional activated sludge, nitrogen, phosphorus removal, BOD removal, growth rates, how to design an activated sludge tank, how to design your aeration, how to design a settling tank. So all the basic steps of activated sludge treatment are dealt with in this bachelor course. So if you're missing things here and you think, well, she goes a bit fast, have a look at the bachelor course, because yeah, it's also on Collegerama and there will be explained more. Who did follow the fundamentals? That's more people. Good. Because also that is background knowledge for this course. Well, we just discussed it. It deals with the basic principles that you need for understanding the technologies we're using in wastewater treatment. So if there are also things here that you think, well, that's a bit strange, or why is it like that, look at the fundamentals Collegerama to see if you can find it there. And I can help you out in that as well, of course. What I would like to do in this first hour, for the time we have left, is to go very rapidly through nitrogen and phosphorus removal. So that's a bit of a repetition from the bachelor course and from the fundamentals course, just to keep you slightly on the same level about nitrogen and phosphorus. Then in the second hour of this course, one of my colleagues from biotechnology will come over, and he's doing his second PhD now. I don't know why, but he's doing his second PhD in Anamox. So he really knows everything about Anamox technology, and he will lecture you about that. Then the third hour, engineer from Waternet, one of the Dutch water treating companies. He will come here to tell you about fine sieves. And in the last bit that is left, we will talk about the practicals. Yeah? So first I go rapidly through NMP removal. Well, we have to remove NMP because we don't want to have eutrophication in our canals and surface water. Eutrophication leads to algae growth. If the algae die, all the oxygen is consumed from the water, and eventually we have a lot of fish death. So that's why we want to remove NMP. If you look at the algae growth equation, you can see that the ratio between NMP is 16 moles of nitrate and 1 mole of phosphorus is needed for algae to grow on. That's their nutrients that they use. So if we have the ideal ratio of NMP is 16N and 1P, that corresponds to 7 milligrams of N and 1 milligram of phosphorus. If you have that in your water in that ratio, you are sure that you will have algae growth. And then 1 milligram of P will lead to 100 milligram of algae in the end, so which is approximately 1 cubic meter of green soup. So you can imagine that if you have a small surface water and you have a wastewater treatment plant discharging with roughly the demands of 1 milligram phosphorus, that is pretty normal in the Netherlands, and 10 milligrams of total nitrogen, which in the end will lead to around 7 milligram of N, you know that you will have quite some, or already quite some algae grow. Well, if we would not treat the wastewater, it would be much more, of course. What we would like to do is go or in a to a phosphorus growth limiting system or a nitrogen growth limiting system. In both ways, we prevent the algae to growth. Phosphorus removal to very low concentrations is much more easy than nitrogen removal. Nitrogen is more mobile, and even some algae can fixate the denitrogen gas from the air, from the atmosphere. So then you can, if you go to a nitrogen limiting system, then in the end the algae just take it from the air and still grow. So it's better to go to phosphorus limitations. But at present, there's both nitrogen and phosphorus control at wastewater treatment plants. In seawater, nitrogen is limiting. But if you look to phosphorus limiting surface water systems, that's really nice. But at the same moment, the soil can also release phosphorus, especially next to agricultural areas, where a lot of fertilizer is used and the phosphorus just flows out to the surface waters. So that is a kind of an, why we are constantly busy with nitrogen and phosphorus removal in treatment plants, even to really, really strict demands. Very quickly through the phosphorus removal, what you learned in the courses before. Processes to remove phosphorus from the wastewater can be done biologically. So, you have a little bit of uptake of phosphorus inside the cells of the organisms. Where's phosphorus used for in the human body? Or in bacterial cells or whatever thing that is growing? Think a bit further. Where does your energy come from? Remember that? Yeah, ATP. So all the energy that is generated in your cells comes from ATP. We need a lot of phosphorus to live. Yeah, so but that is only a little bit. And then we have biological phosphorus removal. I will come to that in the next slide. We can also do chemical precipitation. So with aluminium or iron, that's mostly used to precipitate the phosphorus out, then it ends up in the sludge. Sludge is incinerated in the end, and then we got rid of the phosphorus. It's in the sludge ash. In the end of the lecture series, I come to that we should do that differently. And then lime dosing is also a possibility that is used if you have lake systems. But that only works at pH 10. So it can be used, but it's also not the most optimal way. Biological phosphorus